It's not only about designing a box for people to be in. It's designing an environment. Environment that makes people act in a special way. My name is Kim Nielsen. I'm the founder of 3XN Architects. 3XN stands for 3x Nielsen. And I started the office 33 years ago in 1986, together with two other guys called Nielsen as well. Nielsen is the most common name in Denmark. So we thought it was fun to just to use it three times. Now it's become 3XN. I fell in love with the architecture when I was on a trip to New Zealand after high school. There I met some guys that started at architect school in New Zealand. And I thought it was so interesting and so exciting. So I went back home to Denmark and started at the architect school in Aarhus, the second largest city in Denmark. And after that, I went to work for C.F. Møller's office. That was the biggest office in Denmark at that time. For 5 years, and then we started in 1986 the office 3XN in Aarhus. And now we moved to Copenhagen, to this area here where we have the water next to us. This is an old Navy yard where they used to build a small boat for the Navy 200 years ago. And now I'll show you our office. Right now we are doing more than 90% of our work outside Denmark because there's a big need for buildings. So we're getting offers from all over the world. So we have an office in Sydney, we have one in New York, we have one in Stockholm, one here, and we're starting one up in London. Everything that we do here is teamwork. It's not me that just sit on a napkin and say, design this. No, it is hard work, it is teamwork, and we have done, maybe 20 different models before we came to this model here. So it is a lot of hard work to develop these kind of buildings. We started 14 years ago our GXN department that's sitting down here, and GXN was started to look into new materials and new technologies, green technologies. It's called GXN, the N for Nielsen and G for green, because we wanted to develop some new philosophies and some new tools to work with our buildings.
I'm Kasper Gulager. I'm the founder of GXN. In 3XN, we have a kind of internal innovation company. So we're a group of 20 people working with sustainability. And what we do is really to kind of learn and collaborate and integrate sustainability in all the projects of 3XN. In GXN, we work with circular design, that meaning like designing materials and ecosystems. So learning from nature, because in nature, waste does not exist. So some of the really big agendas that building industry is a part of, like we produce a lot of waste, we're responsible for a huge CO2 consumption. We want to like address that with the logic of nature. How can we design buildings that do things positively? Buildings that actually are designed to be reused over and over again, designed with materials that are healthy, and also designed so it's a positive agenda to do buildings. How can buildings do more good?
Behind me, we have a high-rise that we're right now building in Sydney. That was a competition we won 5 years ago.
Well, in Sydney, we are working with the Key Quarter Tower. So it's like a more than 200 meter tall tower. And we're making a vertical village. So we're actually like stacking five smaller buildings into one high rise. But I think the fascinating thing is that we're actually reusing, or you can say even upcycling, an existing tower. So today there's a tower that was built in the 60s. And this we're actually transforming into this kind of new way of working office tower, reusing 98% of the existing structure. So this has kind of an enormous impact on the environment. We're saving a lot of CO2. But even more interesting, we are also saving a lot of money for the client. So doing this, we are saving 130 million Australian dollars before we even break ground in material and time saved. So we really believe in this kind of, you can say like circular design, try to create cities as urban mining. And also how can we build the future with the waste of today? So some of these big questions are also be put into kind of play in these projects.
We use a lot of time analyzing what every project is about. And then out from these analyses, we do a lot of different physical models like this one here. And we do, of course, a lot of renderings and we work in 3D. But it's all it also comes out of analyzing all the different parts in the building and what's going to happen into the building and how the building fits into the context, into the environment as well.
And you can say that we work with, of course, like digital design, as in, you know, like making smart geometry, making animated design, parametric design. But I think that's just, you know, like at the before we design. Actually, I'd like also to shift to after we complete the building. So actually having smart buildings to give feedback, for example here, what is the humidity, what is the air quality, what is the people movement, how do buildings learn, how can we do smart technology in buildings? So we're really pushing that agenda, and I think that's going to be the next kind of architectural frontier, not just to design building, but like go from building being kind of an object or product to actually be like a relationship. So architects actually are committed for life when they do a building.
So it's becoming very profitable for us to do research as well. And we don't only do research in materials and sustainability, we also do research in architecture and behavior. So we have now four PhDs looking into how different environments have influences in people's behavior. And that is very important when we work with a building like this here, is how will the people inside the building behave? How can they work in there, and how do they feel in the building? Because we design for people, we don't design for ourselves. We do sculptures, but the sculptures has a meaning. It is for the people that's going to inhabit our buildings. It's not for us. In this building here, we work very much with a podium, not only to make a lobby, but to make something that could activate the whole streetscape here with shops and restaurants and cafes that animates the whole streetscape. Because that's another important thing. At the inside of the building and around the building is for the people. Because when people are in the street level, they see it from down here, they don't see it from up here. So it's very, very important what happens down here. I think you see too many high rises as just standing down and nothing happens on the ground level. We want the building to make the place better after it's built than it was before. And that's our motto, by the way.
My name is Jeanette Hansen. I'm an architect and I've worked at 3XN for the last 15 years. The last 3 years I've been the CEO of the company. We hope that 3XN is a very good place to work for our employees. What we deliver is not a product, it's a service. And for us to produce this service to our clients, to our projects, we need to have the best possible staff. And by being an attractive office who offers good conditions for our employees and room to develop, we hope to attract the best staff all over the world. And even though we are a Danish office, we have existed for the last 33 years, we have now become a very international office as well. So in the office here in Copenhagen, we're currently 17 different nationalities, and the official language of the office is English. And we really love this environment because it generates a lot of creativity. We get a lot of input from all over the world. And I think that helps us produce a very good architecture. I think the secret of our work is that there's a healthy work-life balance. We like our employees to work hard and dedicated when they are here, but we also like them to have a family life.
So my name is Kent Clausen, and I work here at 3XN Architects and GXN Innovation, our innovation unit. First of all, it's an amazing place. The neighbors here are the architecture school, it's the film school, so it's a really creative neighborhood. Number two is that because the city is very vibrant, it's nice that it's a bit on the outskirts, close to the water. You have the view every day, you have the water, and the interesting thing is that the water as well can, today it looks nice, but sometimes it can actually go all the way up, so the water can go into the building. So we need to close the doors as well, really nice. And this is a big inspiration for us, because all of our buildings is about how do you get the environment to link with the building.
My name is Laura Wagner. I'm an architect at 3XN, and I've been working here for 7 years today, actually. Working at 3XN is the perfect balance of being able to work on really interesting design projects and being able to draw and design and be an active part of the process, while also being able to have a life where I have good quality outside of work as well, and opportunities to travel and be with my family and my loved ones and spend time outside of the office as well.
Sono Laurent, sono un architetto qua a 3XN, sono di origini italiane, ho studiato in Olanda, sto iniziando ad adattarmi un po' alla vita scandinava, diciamo. Rispetto all'Italia comunque ci sono molti valori in comune, però ad esempio c'è più tempo per concentrarsi anche sulla propria vita o sullo sport, sulla famiglia, tutti questi aspetti che magari in altre realtà vengono un po' meno a mancare, soprattutto il tempo. Si lavora meno, cioè sulla carta sono 37 ore a settimana come architetto normale, però secondo me sono 37 ore che sono molto più efficienti, perché quando sai che devi lavorare 7 ore e mezzo, lavori 7 ore e mezzo senza distrazioni.
I think it's extremely critical to the entire office culture that it's not just about working all the time, but it's also about having the break to recharge and be able to come back to work strong and creative, inspired by the outside world.
I used to be an academic before coming here, and the difference here is it's very much focused on what does this mean for the buildings we're doing. So the focus here is on applied research. Whatever we do here, we got to relate that to architectural design. So we do a lot of stuff where we explore new things. This can be a new technology we don't know what to do with yet. The good thing about being in GXN is that we can take risks, we can work at smaller scales. It's amazing here how many different people from so many different countries and nationalities we have, and so many different backgrounds. I think this is really a diverse working environment. We got people looking at biology, we got people looking at behavior. I'm an anthropologist myself, I'm not an architect. We got engineers, we also got technical experts. So there's really a diverse range of people from all over the world. And what we're trying to do here is bring all these people together, bring all their knowledge together, and see what we can make that adds more value out of that.
3XN è super internazionale in generale come ufficio in Danimarca. Siamo credo 17 nazionalità diverse. In competizioni siamo la maggior parte, siamo internazionali. Italiani siamo adesso in 4. Le persone qua sono magnifiche, ci si diverte un casino, si lavora bene, c'è tanta attenzione nella qualità dei progetti, però anche nella qualità della vita. Ci si diverte sia nel progetto che qui fuori dal progetto, quindi secondo me quella è una cosa molto importante. E comunque è un ambiente internazionale molto stimolante e accattivante in generale.
So my name is Susan Carruth. I am the head of operations for GXN, and I also lead GXN's behavioural cluster. I think the space itself, if that's what you're asking to. Well, of course, I believe in this relationship between behaviour and architecture, so I very much think that this space does shape how we work. It's very open and collaborative in that sense. We have these, you know, GXN are here, we do have our own discrete space, but we're very much in close connection and contact with 3XN. And I think it's also, this building's a really good example of some of the things that we try and instill in our workplace projects. For example, with the natural materials, with the views and the connection between indoors and outdoors, and nature is important. And the sense that even though, yes, this is open plan, there is this sense of different zones and bays and, you know, areas of particular focus.
And one reason to send your CV to 3XN is because if you come as an intern, then you have the best experience where you get to actually be part of a design team and have your ideas heard by the project team, because everyone gets to have their drawing on the wall and their idea considered. So it could be your idea, or it could be the partner, or it could be an architect. All different people have an opportunity to contribute to the design process.
Yeah, you can jump in the water. If I can swim, yes, the water around Copenhagen is clean, so you can jump in from each harbour side and just jump in and swim around. Yes.
Vado adesso, tra l'altro. Adesso era il costume qua, abbiamo tutti il costume qua, e qua adesso che finiamo alle 5 andiamo tutti a fare il bagno.
The city fish market will start. We'll start building that this autumn, their springtime, because they have the opposite time as we have. It's a very exciting project we won 2 years ago, and I think it will be finished in 3 years' time.
Yeah, well, I'm Alden Opdahl. I'm senior partner in 3XN Architects, and I'm partner in charge on the Sydney fish market. So I think one of the most interesting things about this project is the actual question that was given from the municipality. It's the state of New South Wales, which is our client. And their brief was basically, you should deliver a world-class fish market. And our reaction to that was, well, we should deliver much more than that. It's located at the waterfront. When we build at waterfronts, it comes also with responsibility. We should bring the city all the way down to the edge. This should be a public space. So you can describe the Sydney fish market as going actually back to the traditional market. It's as much a plaza than an actual building. So it should be for every user. Or it should be from Sydney, people from Sydney, tourists.
This project is more than a fish market. It's also a catalyzer for activities in the whole area. It is an anchor for it in the whole community. It's going to be a sort of a community center as well. It's where people go to eat, to buy food, and to meet, and to just have a joyful time and see the activity, exciting activity that is around fishing boats and like that, and handling fish. In Sydney, they have more than 500 different species of fish. So it's a very exciting place to go. It's going to be a massive anchor, going to be a massive attraction in Sydney.
The state wanted us to make a world-class fish market, but we actually came back and said, well, it's a world-class fish market, but what it really should do is connect people. That's what it should do. It should connect the city with the water, but what it also should do is connect industry with basically recreational activities. And that is one thing that is quite unique with the fish market. Most industrial functions all over the world is moving out of the harbors, but Sydney chose to let the fish market be there. It's an industrial function. So what we created is a geometry that could accommodate both public access down to the waterfront, but also an industrial function. So you can see the promenade is lifted above the industrial wharf, for example. So it provides public access to the waterfront, but it also provides a much better industrial facility for those two worlds to kind of work together instead of against each other. And I think this is what we're going to experience in the future as well. I think one of the things that I like to talk about is the passive user. And the passive user is basically the user that was not intended to use the building in the first place. So, you know, you could say it a little bit tacky, but you shouldn't necessarily like sushi to be at the Sydney fish market. You should also just be there
as part of Sydney. So that's a user that's actually been very important of driving our design. So yes, it's very important, and I think we should all, as architects, we have a big responsibility to make sure that the public is addressed in every single building we do. When you see the building, there are certain things that are there permanently. It's the roof, the stairs. The roof makes the building work. It brings air, it's all these technological aspects that I talked about earlier. And then the stairs, they are basically mediating between the public realm and the market itself. So it makes the building work. But there are other aspects to it that are, we know that a market changes over time. Well, a traditional market, for example, in Italy, this is where some of the first markets were, it will change from day to day. And it's basically the same for a market like this. It will change. So there are actually many aspects of this building that is flexible, that is designed to actually disassemble the parts. So I think when we develop Architect Furger, it's actually also being intelligent to see how can we reuse the buildings in the future? How can we change them to address the kind of other challenges or whatever is coming in the future? But that there are also things that need to be there to make the building work at the moment. So I believe that not everything should be flexible, but we should be intelligent what we make flexible.
I think what is happening now is very exciting and very scary times we are in now, because you know how the world and the climate change, and we have so hot here today, unusually hot. It is probably part of the climate change as well. So these challenges we see as good things for us, because we have to live up to them. We have to create architecture a lot different from what we did 20 or 30 years ago. Now it's not only about four walls and a roof. Now it's about how the building is performing for the people inside, outside, how it's generating energy, and how it's performing in the cityscape, and how you can densify cities and all this. So it is very exciting times we're living in. Architecture has turned to be, we said in the old days, we said it's not rocket science, but it has turned now to be rocket science, because there's so many things you have to look into. When we did the IOC building, we ended up having the most sustainable building in the world, the LEED Platinum building that got the most points. And this is what we think is a great challenge, and this is what we want to achieve with the future buildings as well.
My name is Jan Amundsen. I'm a senior partner, head of design here at 3XN in Copenhagen. The IOC project, which we've been working on for since 2013, started out as a competition. And this is some of the first models from the process. This is actually some of the first, a little bit of a bigger models that show some of the ideas, and they're pretty much all there today. We started out fairly big models, and also in the background you can see some of our facade studies. But what they all do, you can see they are in family, all of these. But they are taking steps on this tour of us, of ours, from a complex building. But we wanted to come up with a simple scheme that kind of captures a lot of complex stories. This is actually pretty much close to what is built now today. We have a chateau. We have this dynamic building that kind of captures the park. We have a facade that moves and undulating like a step motion movie from facade piece to facade piece. The staircase plays a double, or you could say a triple role. It's of course the rings, the IOC, so it's core identity for IOC. It's the staircase that brings people up and down, but it also is designed in such a way that it creates these kind of social zones. So it's not one continuous staircase, as you'll see. It's actually pieces of staircase that brings you one floor up, and then we have these social zones on all floors. So that in that way, it kind of forces people within the building to meet each other. The project started out as a competition, and for us, really early, we had huge ambitions with this. It was clear to us that the IOC had huge ambitions as well. So, for instance, the facade of the building that you see now, it's a moving facade, or you can say that it moves, but to be honest, I mean, a building is not moving anywhere, and that's actually the idea with the building. It should stay, and it should stay for a long time. So, for us to see if we could actually work with some kind of picture of movement, and this is the, there we had this picture of stop motion kind of athlete going from one position to another. They kind of captures a movement somehow in one moment, and we worked with the same picture, and that is what you can see in the facade. The other main one was also the five rings. The five, you cannot, it's really hard to think on the IOC and not think about the five rings on the white flag. So we tried to work with that as well. And we came up with this idea to try to make it into the staircase because that makes it all of a sudden not just a sculpture or a piece, but actually a practical and a functional thing. And we like that way of thinking. So it's not just for the idea of to have the rings, but also actually to see if we could make it into a practical kind of solution. I think that's to have a challenge or to have high ambitions with projects is definitely what can drive a good architecture. When you have kind of a little bit of a hard task, then sometimes that's actually when you can get some extraordinary architecture out of it. You need to somehow have a little bit of a fight. You need to do the best, and for the whole team to do their best. So it's not bad. I believe in when you do architects to have these kind of constraints that can drive the architecture in a different way, in a different direction that you'll normally do. Everyone who's been involved in this, not only the architects at our site, but also everyone who's been working on the project later, feels that they have pushed the limits of what they normally do. And I also believe that they have a feeling that they have produced something different. And that is, I think, for everyone, a fantastic feeling. It's a fantastic feeling that you have when you have finished something where you actually tried your best, and everyone who's been involved seems like they've been doing the same thing. So that's a fantastic feeling first. Because I mean, first you can do a vision of a building, but everyone needs to kind of think it's a good idea and work in that direction and make it happen in the end. So there's hundreds of people that need to go in the same direction for that to happen. And that has been quite a journey, a fantastic journey. So and now when you see it's there, of course it's a little bit sad because you will not be working on it, but it's also a fantastic feeling that it actually was possible to finish it and do it. Yeah.
I have dreams every day. I think every day is a new challenge and new things comes up, and every day surprises me. So the dream is of course to that we do things better and we are in the lead in the world. That's my dream, that we have to be that. There, of course, I live for architecture. Architecture is my hobby. This is the only thing more or less I do 24/7. So even on my holidays and go and look at buildings or look at environments. Of course, I relax as well, but I think architecture is it's the most important thing because it's what you are in or around all the time. So my dream is to make buildings that makes the environment better and makes the life for people better. Can't stop, won't stop. Can't stop, won't stop.